Okay, guys, next topic is left recursion. Okay, so recursion means what? Repetition. Okay, repeatedly, if you are defining towards left side, okay, it means that left side, I already told you what are there in the left side of your production. Non terminals are there, right? So, those non terminals, if you are repeatedly you are defining, then it is called as left recursion, and particularly. Just one very nice trick or tips I want to tell you is, if your production is looking like this, suppose here one example I have written, right? Example of a production. Production looks like this. Expression is deriving expression plus a term. Okay. So here both of them are written in italics. Then you should understand that they are non-terminals. It means that right now still I don't know what is the meaning of expression. Again, I have to define expression. Maybe that expression will be defined like this, expression minus term or something. Again, that expression will be defined like this, term plus term, term minus term, term into term, term divided by term, like this maybe. Okay. So at that time, then expression will be completely defined. And term also, I don't know. So all terms here, right side, you keep on getting term, right? So this is also a non-terminal. So you have to define what is that term actually. The term may be either, operand it is actually, okay. So term may be either identifier or else it may be a number, okay. So just one example I have taken, one production example I have taken, expression is deriving the expression plus term, okay. So in this production, left side is there, no, whatever I have written here, EXPR, it is called as a head of that production. Already I told you, here I have written with pencil. Right side is called as a body of that production. So if you observe that body of that your production, and in fact, particularly if you look into the leftmost of your body, in the leftmost, there is a non-terminal is there. So which is the same as your head or start symbol or symbol, which is in the LHS, which is a same as a non-terminal. So here, if your non-terminal is immediately repeating at the RHS side or at the body of your production immediately once again, then it is called as a left recursive production. I hope you understand. Okay. So left recursive productions are nothing but the productions in which the head is immediately repeated at the right side or at the body of the production. Then it is called as left recursive production. Remember. So one example I tell you here for left recursive production. This is a left recursive production. Why? Because A is a non-terminal. The same non-terminal is repeated once again at the RHS side. That is in the body of the production. Okay. So if you will keep on defining this A, so then you will keep on defining it towards the left side only. It means your tree will grow, tree will grow downwards. And particularly towards left side like this, in this direction. You just observe my arrow mark. In this direction, your tree will grow. So because of that only, it is called as a left recursive production. Okay. So one more production I have written here. Here alpha and beta is there, right? Alpha and beta are sequences of terminals and non-terminals that do not start with the A. Okay, you just leave it. Okay. So here, you come here. One more example is there. Expression is deriving expression plus term, or else the second production is expression may be term also. So instead of using two separate lines or two separate productions or rules, in the same line only I have written two productions here. First production is expression is deriving expression plus term. Second production is deriving is expression is deriving a term. So here also two productions are there, okay? Because of this pipeline, we can easily say that there are two productions are there. It means A will be either A alpha or else A will be only beta, okay? Here also expression will be either expression plus term or else expression will be only term, okay? So here, so if you consider this expression or production of your grammar with this grammar, so here expression is nothing but A. When we compare these two productions, expression is nothing but A, and expression, as already told, it is A, but what is remaining here? Plus term is there. This plus term is nothing but alpha, and this pipeline is as it is here, and this term is nothing but beta here. So here A is nothing but expression, and string alpha is nothing but it is a plus term, and string beta is nothing but it is a term. Okay, so why I am telling these all things? Because here I am going to show you parse trees, particularly left recursive parse trees, parsing, and left recursive parse trees. Because here, once again, I have written that production here. A is deriving A alpha. If you keep on replacing this A with A alpha, okay, because A is nothing but what? A is nothing but what? A alpha, right? So if you keep on replacing this A with A alpha, you will get A alpha followed by alpha. Again, if you replace this A with A alpha, you will get A alpha followed by 2 alpha. Okay, like this, this it will keep on continuing. At last, suppose if you want to replace that A value as a alpha, if you want to replace that A value as a beta, because previously I told you in this grammar, A is not only A alpha, A is beta also. So A can take beta also, beta form also. So then after some continuous definitions, then if you replace that A by beta, then you will get a beta followed by n number of alpha. Okay, so if you are keep on defining like this A, this A will keep on growing like this. Okay, so this alpha is keep on remaining a constant. So this A is keep on deriving like this towards the left side. So here, left recursive parse tree I have written here, that is A is a alpha, A alpha, A alpha, A alpha, 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 like this. At last, if you replace A by B, then beta, then your string, whatever you are getting at the RHS side, that string will be beta followed by alphas. It is here. Okay. Similarly, one more example, if you consider for a left recursive, it is one grammar with the two productions. A is deriving a beta R. Here you can observe here A is not repeated anywhere in the RHS side. So you cannot say that it is a left recursive. Okay. Then if you observe second production, R is deriving alpha R. So here also R is not repeating at the RHS side immediately. Of course it is repeating, but it is in the second place, not in the first place. So it is also not a left recursive grammar or left recursive production. It is just a production. It is not left recursive production. It is a right recursive production. Okay. So you cannot say that it is a left recursive production. So here it is a right recursive production. So you should keep on what we do here actually. Here R is there, no? What is the value of R? Alpha R. So if you replace this R by alpha R, then you will get the string as a string here as a beta alpha R. Beta alpha alpha R. Beta alpha 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 R, like this you will get. And also R is not only alpha R. R is at end, R may be epsilon also, that is empty string also. So once you keep on deriving this, and if you get the string like this here, A is a beta followed by R, that R is I replaced here as a alpha with again R. So like this, if you keep on continuing like this, you will get the string as a beta followed by n number of alpha followed by one empty string, that is epsilon. This is a string what you got from this grammar. This is the string what you got from the previous grammar, that is this grammar. Okay, so this is about the left recursive and the right recursive. Okay, I think you understood what is the left recursive and right recursive. Now next concept is a symbol table. As I already told you in the first topic only, in the second module, there we were studying the compilation process. Okay, that is the structure of a compiler. There in that diagram, you might have observed, we have a symbol table at our left side. These all seven phases of our compilation process will be keep on communicating with this symbol table. Okay, so it means that they are going to insert some information in that symbol table. Information means in the sense what, sir? So information is nothing but whenever it takes any input from the lexical analyzer, and lexical analyzer will create it in the lexemes, and lexemes will be created as tokens, and tokens will be given to the syntax analyzers, and syntax analyzers will create the syntax tree or parse tree, right? So these all phases will be keep on storing some information in this symbol table, and what type of symbol information they will store or save in this symbol table, we should understand. Okay, so the entries in this symbol table will contain different variety of information. For example, these symbol tables may be containing some identifiers, that is nothing but variables. Okay, and not only variables, along with variables, it will contain the type of variable. It means whether it is a data integer type of variable, floating point of variable, or character or double, what type of variable it is. That data type also it contains, in addition to the data type and the variable, it contains the position in the storage. Its position is nothing but memory location. What is variable? It is a name given to the memory location, right? So what is that address of that memory? What is that location of that memory? That is also present in this symbol table. Okay, and similarly, any other relevant information, if you require, that all relevant information will be present in this symbol table. Clear? Then, tree address code, which is very important, okay, and interesting also. So just briefly, I tell you idea now, but in the last module, fifth module, you have one separate chapter or so, one big topic on this tree address code, which is very easy and interesting. Once you understand that problem, you will solve very easily, don't worry. So tree address code, as its name itself is a tree address code, it is a code. What is the code? It is a block of code. Code is nothing but what? It is a block of statements, set of statements, a sequence of statements, or sequence of instructions, or a sequence of executable statements. Okay, and particularly these sequence of instructions, and each and every instruction is in this form. Which form? Tree address form. Tree address means what, sir? It is because it uses three operands, and it uses only one operator. So because of that only it is named as a tree address code. So this tree address code or tree address instructions will be in this format or syntax: x equal to y, operator z. You can observe here x, y, and z are three operands, only one operator is there, that is operator, right? So because of this form, it is called as a tree address code. And what is the, sir, actually this tree address code? See, you know, after semantic analysis, that is third phase of our compilation process, there are next phases are there, code generation phases. So before directly generating your target code or object code, which is a machine level language or low level language, first we should convert our high level language into the intermediate code. Intermediate code is nothing but slowly you are converting, slowly you are translating your high level program into low level program. So in that journey, you will get one form of your program. That form is nothing but this is intermediate form. So usually we write that intermediate form in this tree address code, as a tree address code. I hope you are understanding. It is just like you know, guys, whenever we start to write any program, directly we don't write it. First we write the algorithm, then we write the flow chart. Okay, then if still you are not satisfied, and if still you are not getting confidence, then you will write a pseudocode for it. Okay, so not directly, instead of writing a program, first we write a pseudocode for it. What is pseudocode? Pseudocode is a mixture of your algorithm and your actual C program. So it is a mixture of both English language and C language or any other programming language. So it is an intermediate between algorithm, which is purely written in English, and the mixture of English as well as your actual programming language. Similarly here, intermediate code we have to generate before generating a target code or object code. So that intermediate code will be in this form only, that is a tree address code only. Okay, so I will tell you clearly about these three address instructions and three address code in the last module, fifth module. If you want, you observe today, in your syllabus. Last module contains this very important topic and fixed question in fifth module. Very easy and short and small module, fifth module. I will tell you clearly there. Okay. So here, if you want to take one more example for three address code, you can take this one. That is x of y is equal to z. What happens here? Again, three operators are here. Sorry, three operands are here. Okay. So what happens actually here? The value of z is assigned to the array, that is x of y. And here in second statement, what is going on here? Y of z value is going to be assigned to the variable x, right? So like this, three address code is there. And next portion is our actual module. So that I want to show you one second. So this is a third module, which is a syntax analysis. Here completely, whatever the briefly I have discussed, we are going to study them once again in detail. That's all. So in between, you may get some type of this type of ideas like grammar, left recursive, right recursive, these all things. So because of that explanation in the, during the module, briefly already I have given you the idea here only. Okay. So then here, the first topic is introduction. Okay, as per our syllabus, it is a C 3.1. Okay, but in your textbook, it is 4.1. It's the 3.1. Since I am talking about the third module, first topic, that is introduction. So it is 3.1, and in that one, first subtopic is there. That is 3.1.1. That is the role of a parser. I think the same type of topic already you have studied in the second module also. That is the role of a lexical analyzer. Similarly, here you are going to study the role of the parser or role of the syntax analysis, what exactly it does. Okay, so here you can observe here. Already I told you in a previous module how exactly lexical analyzer will communicate with the syntax analyzer or parser. Already I told you, you know, whenever we are traveling in a bus, two passengers we are sitting beside, and you are alone. And beside you, some person will come and sit there. And I think both of you feel that somewhere I have seen him, somewhere I have seen him. But you are expecting that let him to communicate first with me. And he is also expecting the same thing. First, let him to talk to me first. So like this, here also the competition is there. And in that one competition, that lexical analyzer will definitely, it will win the competition, because I am joking here. See, among these two, lexical analyzer and the syntax analyzer, so who needs a token actually? Parser needs a token, correct? So first, what it does, it sends a command to this lexical analyzer. It sends a request to lexical analyzer. Hey, lexical analyzer, please give me a token so that I can create a or develop a or draw a token. That is a parse tree or syntax tree as my output. Okay, so then lexical analyzer will receive this request, and it will start to scan once again. Of course, it will be keep on receiving the input characters from our source code or source program. Then for those all source programs, input characters, it will make a particularly lexemes. For examples, suppose you have written a if statement in your program. First, small letter I will be the input to this lexical analyzer. Next input will be small letter F. Next input will be open parenthesis. Definitely, when a lexical analyzer received open parenthesis, then it understands that, oh, it is not a lexeme, it is not a character which is belonging to the lexeme called keyword. Because IF, if it can be put into the group or lexeme called keyword, but open parenthesis is not possible to add there. It is a punctuation or any symbol it is. So like this, it will understand lexical analyzer. It will make a group of these input characters. Those are called as a lexemes. And for every lexeme, there will be a token, and that lexeme will match our pattern. Okay. So based on that pattern only, it will categorize them. Okay. So then these lexemes will have a token, and token will be having a two parts, token name and attribute value. So that token will be generated by lexical analyzer, then those all tokens will be forwarded to parser. And after receiving that token, what this parser does, so as its output is a parse tree, by taking those all tokens with the help of the grammars, it will create a parse tree. Okay, just now I told you, by giving a grammar, somebody will ask you to draw a parse tree. So by as per or according to that grammar, so it will take the token, and according to that grammar, it will generate the parse tree or syntax tree as an output, which will be in turn in input to the next phase, which is a semantic analysis. So these are next rest of these front end or analysis phase. Okay, so then here you can observe here, next what we are getting here, we are getting intermediate representation. Intermediate, it is not a complete representation of my object program or translated program or machine level program or a low level program. It is still intermediate. Okay, intermediate code itself is called as one method I have selected or I have chosen is a three address code. So of course it is not the only one method, we can adopt any other methods also. So here in our syllabus we have adopted a three address code, which is representing your source program, but it is going to match nearly to your object program or target program. Okay, so it is an intermediate representation of your program. Okay, your source is your source program, and your destination will be your target program or your object program, which is a low level language. But in between them, there are some flows are there because of these processes. It is slowly keep on translating, slowly it is keep on translating, and some point of time it will get this intermediate representation, which is a middle in between source program and the target program. Okay, so and as I already told you, all phases of our compilation process will be keep on communicating with the symbol table to insert the information as well as to fetch the information from this symbol table, right? So this is about introduction. And there are three types of parsers are there. Okay, three types of parsers, I mean three types of syntax analyzers for our grammars. So those three types, what are those three types? Universal parser, as its name itself is a universal, what it does, can you expect anything? It will draw the parse tree or syntax tree for all grammars, for all type of grammars. Okay, and next parser is a top down parser. What it does, so it generates the parse tree. Okay, it generates the parse tree starting from the root node to leaf node. Because of that only we call it as a top down. Okay, so it will start to scan that grammar from the first production to last production, that is from root node to leaf node, that is non-terminal to terminal. Okay, that is a top down, top down it is. Okay, next type of parser is a bottom up parser. It's a reverse, bottom up. It means that it starts to construct the syntax tree or parse tree from a bottom, from the bottom, and then it will reach the root node at the end. It means that it will scan your grammar from the last production, particularly in that also right side, whatever you have written the terminal, no, from that terminal, it will start its journey and it will go back to the start symbol of your grammar, which is in the LHS of your first production. Guys, are you hearing me what I am telling, my pronunciation? Okay, my explanation, you should listen carefully, very important topics I am discussing. Okay, so universal parser can parse any grammar. For any grammar, it will generate the parse tree or syntax tree. Okay, so here, but these are not sufficient, these are inefficient, whatever the parse tree it will be generated, no, so they are not perfect or efficient parse trees. So because of that only we should adopt either top down or else bottom up. Again, particularly these are top down or bottom up, they are suitable for some particular type of recursion methods. Okay, I will come to that point later. Just see here what I am talking about is, as already told, by their names, top down method build the parse trees from the top to bottom, that is from root node to leaf node. At the same time, the bottom up method is nothing but it starts the construction of a tree from the leaf node to the root node. Okay, so here the input to the parser is scanned from left to right, one symbol at a time. One symbol at a time. It means the parser will be keep on accepting or scanning the input from left to right, and one character or one symbol or one alphabet or one letter at a time. One by one, all the character it takes. The most efficient methods are top down and bottom up. The first one was there, no, universal. It is not efficient. Okay. So these most efficient methods will work only for a subclasses of grammars. See, I already told you, subclasses of grammars. They are not suitable for all grammars. They are suitable for only some specific type of grammars. So those grammars are what type of grammars, sir? Those grammars are two types of grammars are here. LL grammar and LR grammar. Okay. LL is nothing but, as its name itself is LL, it is about left recursive. Left. Sorry. LL is about L. Okay. So I tell you exact meaning of this LL later. Okay. So here, one more is there. One more grammar, that is LR grammar. That is left recursive, which are very much expressive or very much clear. They are going to give us a very clear idea about the language or our grammar. Okay. So here, we will see. This LL grammar, whatever I have told you, for this LL grammar, it is very easy for us to draw the parse trees for LL grammars. In fact, the fact is, even by our hand also, we can draw these parse trees or syntax trees for this LL grammars. That much easy it is. But for LR grammars, we cannot draw the parse trees or syntax trees with our hand. Okay. So parsers for large classes of LR grammars are usually constructed using the automated tools. Automated tools. There are some automated tools are there. Okay. So parsers are nothing but your syntax analyzers. For these LR grammars, there are some automated tools are there. They will produce these syntax tree or parse tree, or else you can consider parsers only. Okay. So for LL, even by human beings, we can also draw the parse trees with our hand. Okay. This is about first part. And next point is representative grammars. Representative grammars. Okay. Guys, let me to wind up the class today here only. In the next class, I continue from this second topic. That is 3.1.2. That is representative grammars. Okay. So there you will get a clear idea about LL grammar and LR grammar. Okay. So thank you for joining. You can leave the meeting now. In next class, I continue this second topic.